So good afternoon again. If you can reduce the volume a little bit, sir. Thank you. We want to get started here now. But before we do that, I don't want to be negligent not to apologize for running a little bit late. And our pastor got stuck in traffic, you know, with all the infrastructure going on around the church. We wish you could have flown him from where he was stuck for a minute, but we are ready to start. And so the family will be walking in again with the pastor as we get started in a formal way. And I ask that as they come in, if you would please stand and remain standing for our opening hymn and our prayer. Thereafter, I will usher you to sit down and we will follow the program as it is. So again, we want to get started and we want to welcome you to Ushindi for this celebration of life and being reminded that when we met Andrew, for those of all of us that met Andrew in whichever way that you are connected to Andrew, is that when we meet friends and family, many times we may have met them for such a time as this. And so when this has happened, I want to thank you for making time and being careful to celebrate a friend's life, a brother's life, and maybe a classmate's life. And therefore, as we go through this, I invite all of us to be in one accord as we begin the service. As may God bless all of us as we do that. May you stand, please. Can play the music, please. Team, the chorister. So I'll invite the chorister to begin to help us out with the songs, and all the songs are written in the bulletin. So if you can turn to Nearer My God to Thee, that's our first hymn. Good. Okay, we'll continue. Susan.
To thee. Praise the Lord. My name is Susan. I'm the First Lady of Ushindi. We welcome you all into this sanctuary. I am going to say a prayer, but before I say, I want to express my condolences to the Suge family. We are thinking about you and we're praying for you. We are sorry for your loss. Let us pray. Everlasting Father, we come to your presence this afternoon, O God. With thanksgiving in our hearts, oh my Father. Thank you for gathering us here today, oh my Father, even to mourn our brother. Jehovah, may your presence manifest in this place today. We bless you, oh my Father, because we know you are the giver of life, oh Jehovah. And even as our brother has ascended, oh God, I pray that you will continue to comfort his family, oh Jehovah. As we mourn our loved one today, oh my Father, may you bring healing to our hearts, oh God. May you touch us, oh God, even as you have promised that you will comfort those who are mourning. And so today, oh my Father, we pray that you will comfort his family, his friends, and the extended community, oh my Father. Andrew is a son, a husband, a father, a brother, a nephew, a niece, an uncle. Father, we pray that you will comfort all his family, O Jehovah. We bless you because you are the source of our strength. Be their strength, O God. Be their refuge, O my Father. Be their rock. Provide for them, O God. We bless you. Thank you, Jesus. You are our Alpha and Omega. Even as we eulogize him, as we share the memories, oh God, may those memories bring us joy, bring us healing. Thank you, Father. We honor you and we glorify your name this afternoon. We commit this service into your presence. Be with us. Walk with us. Order our steps, oh God. Bless each and every person that will share today. Bless each and every person that is mourning with their family. For we love you and we adore you. In Jesus' name we pray and believe. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated, please. And so as we begin, again, thank you, the praise team. Thank you, the First Lady. To the family, we opened up before you came in, and so in a very special way, we want to pause, and to Maggie, to Ashley, to Ryan, to Zoe, and to Noah, the immediate family, the extended family here present, as well as the friends and the community and their church from Eagle Mountain, if I'm not mistaken. We want to say we express our condolences, and we stand with you. And so in this service, as we begin, I'd like to call upon Ashley Suge and Zoe Suge to read the scriptures. They'll be reading the Old Testament and the New Testament. So Ashley and Zoe, if you may, please.
I lift up my eyes to the mountain. Where does my help from come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over you, your coming and going, both now and forevermore.
Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. there is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am, and you know the way to where I am going. No, we don't know, Lord, Thomas said. We have no idea where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Ashley and Zoe. Thank you. Thank you so much. That is touching that you can testify the God that your father knew as you read those scriptures. We're going to invite Dr. Honey Chiriot to do the eulogy, please, if you may. And that will be followed by a presentation, a slideshow, where we'll have the family pictures, and they'll be up here again to lead us in the family tributes and speeches. So, Honey, if you please.
Before I start, I just want to express my sincere condolences to Andrew Suge's family, to the entire family. Andrew Kipkemoi Suge was born on March 28, 1974 in Kericho, Kenya, to Nehemiah and Lily Suge and the late Rebecca Suge of Chepsir, Kericho County. He was called home to glory on Friday, June 3, 2022 in Fort Worth, Texas. Early life and education. Andrew attended elementary school, first at St. Andrew's Turi, and later at Kericho Primary School, where he sat for his KCPE. He then attended St. Patrick's Eton for his high school education. In 1995, Andrew moved to the United States and attended Millersville University in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. It was in Lancaster that he built many lasting friendships in a large Kenyan community that had settled there. Andrew continued his education online at Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma. In 2020, Andrew answered the call to ministry. He enrolled in the Kenneth Copeland Bible College, and this past May 2022, he graduated with an associate's degree in biblical studies. We rejoiced with him as we saw him accomplish a lifelong dream, work life. Andrew was an entrepreneur at heart who ventured into business whenever an opportunity presented itself. He worked in the healthcare field, Department of Transportation, and most recently at FedEx in Fort Worth. He made many lasting friendships at work, and we know he will be missed by all his colleagues. Church life. Andrew led his family in worship, and they were longtime members at New Beginnings Worship Center and Dynamic Life Praise and Worship Center in Virginia. More recently, they were members of Eagle Mountain International Church in Newark, Texas. He was very active in its men's ministry and enjoyed serving in other areas of church. Andrew's amazing spirit and warm smile will never be forgotten. He ensured that all who met him knew him. He was always willing to lend a helping hand to anyone in need and made everyone feel important and loved. He loved the Lord, and while we'll miss him so much, we will find comfort in knowing that he's home with the Lord. May his soul rest in eternal peace. Family. Andrew comes from a large family in Kenya, whom he loved and cared for. He had a special close relationship with his parents, who instilled in him a love for God and his word, family, friendship, handwork, dedication, and perseverance. This foundation would only nurture his call to ministry. Andrew was the dedicated older brother of the late Robert, Catherine, Rutich, Gladys, Isaac, Salat, Caroline, Fanuel, Okal, Peter Rutich, and Leonard Caroline Rutich. He's also the beloved brother of Ruth, the late Henry, Susan, Helen, Emily, Bernard, and the late David, Kenneth, and Jennifer. He's an in-law to Samari and Stella, and many nieces and nephews. Andrew met Maggie Kipyab in Virginia. They had been classmates and childhood friends in elementary school. They married in December 22nd, 2007, and lived in Virginia until 2020, when they moved to Texas. Andrew is a proud father of four beautiful and adorable children. His oldest two, Ashley and Ryan, are in college. The younger children are Zoe and Noah. Andrew also gained an extended family through his union with Maggie, as well as Ashley and Ryan's family. He is loved and will be missed by the Kipyab family of Elgeyo Marakwet County, the Mutai family of Houston, Texas, Kericho County, Uncle Peter Kamau, Cousin Jane Jerry of Massachusetts, Cousin Ernest Sang of North Carolina, and many nephews and nieces.
Thank you for that eulogy. We appreciate it. I will alter the program a little bit as the presentation is getting ready. And so we move to the tributes. And we want to begin giving a chance to the children to say, pay their tributes to their dad. We only have children, so I guess all of you can speak if you are able to. Did you have anybody who wants to present? All of you are welcome to speak, please. So Ryan, Ashley, Zoe, you're welcome to come and say anything you want to say about your dad, to pay your tributes. And then that will be followed. We'll play a video from Pastor Sam Harrell, and the other video should be ready by then. You can come up or I can give you the mic. You can come up.
All right. So it's not really, I do want to thank everybody here for coming out. Although, despite the circumstances, we do have family that's, you know, kind of supporting us through the whole process. My dad has told me and my sister before, you know, we are just a flesh. You know, his soul is with God now, so I know he's happy. And like I said, it's really not too much for me to say, but I thank y'all all for coming out and really being a shoulder that we can kind of lean on and cry on if we need to. So, thank you guys.
I agree. I'll try to keep it brief and not cry like I want to.
But thank you all so much for coming. So many things I would love to ask him and tell him, but like Ryan said, he's with Jesus now and he didn't have to worry about anything. And I'm just so grateful that he steered us on that path to chase that relationship with the Lord and learn our scripture and learn our Bibles. I just pray he rest in peace.
Yeah, and just to end it, it's kind of like a little cheesy quote that I heard, but you know, don't cry because it's over, you know, smile because it happened. So I do thank God for the life that he was able to, you know, live and teach us a couple of things in order to, you know, kind of get us through life, because it isn't easy. So, other than that, rest in peace to my dad. I loved him. Love you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ryan and Ashley. We appreciate taking the courage to pay your tributes to loving dad. And when he's been called to go home, I'm glad that you can remember well what he taught you. So that when people are gone, it's not what they did, but what they taught us that remains with us. And I'm grateful that you can do that as his children. Zoe, did you want to say anything? Okay. Are we ready with the presentation? Okay, so we'll move on to the presentation now, the slideshow, and then I'll come back again.
Fahamu kuwa ni yako zam angalau ungeniambia eti unakam nitulize ham wangu wa dhati. Hey, tama zangu zimenikwamia mikono. Mi bila faham kuwa ni yako zam angalau ungeniambia eti unakam nitulize ham wangu wa dhati. Hey, tama zangu zimenikwamia mikononi.
Natamani kujua what your plot is. Ata landlord upeana notice. Akima ulana, ingilia kati. Peace ni expensive but worth it. Kwa nini, ulia mwakutango lea. Dayat yangu ime change. Tabia kulea, usingizi na kutamani. Kushoto kulia, unakuja lini. Nitabasamu tena. Unanitenda, ile kuchukua sijui nani alimtuma. Maombi ni ati wakati rudi nyuma. Joni nikirudi, nikupate kwa nyumba. Jiji zimeshikana ni ngumu kuvunja. But kauna raka, ne.
Good, thank you. Thank you for that presentation. If you allow me, I will translate for those who may not have understood the language. In a nutshell, the song says, we will see each other again. So we'll meet again. So I hope that gives us comfort that when people are called home, it's not the end of seeing them. And so when that time comes, family, you may take comfort that there is another time that we can again meet with dad, with friend, with husband, or with anyone else, the way we knew Andrew to be. And so right now, we're going to have another link, another presentation from Andrew's brother-in-law, Pastor Sam Harrell. I don't know if we have that link ready.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Pastor Sam Harrell, and I am Andrew's brother-in-law. I have the privilege of being married to Rhoda Harrell, who is Maggie's sister. We are really honored by your presence here today in honor of Andrew's life. And I just want to say a few words of Thanksgiving tribute to him. You know, time and distance did keep us from seeing each other as often as we'd like, but Andrew was twice my brother. He was my brother through marriage to my beautiful sister-in-law, Maggie, and father to our precious nephew, Noah, and beautiful niece, Zoe. But he was also my brother in Christ. He loved his family, and he loved Jesus. And I recall when he drove trucks for a living, how he had a big sign on his truck that invited people to come to Jesus. And I see that love of Christ emanating through the family, through his home, and witness in Zoe's smile. I was honored to meet his father and mother in my visit to Kericho, Kenya just a few years ago. We had chai, and I got to say chumge. And I will always honor Andrew's life by standing with you, Maggie, and the children. Rhoda and I are here for you, and you know that you are in our hearts. So rest in peace, my brother, until we meet again. For Harry, buenas if you will.
Thank you, amen. Good, again, thank you so much, Pastor Sam Harrell. And Pastor Sam Harrell is represented here today by his wife, Rhoda, Maggie's sister. So again, as a family, we want to say, Paula, and thank you for bringing that to us. I'll now invite Joan Kagezi, a family member, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming to grace us on this occasion. I didn't know I was going to be on the program, but Rhoda, thanks to you. But there's so much to say. Andrew was married to my sister Cheryl before he met Maggie. He's forever a brother-in-law, and we loved him with every fiber of our being. When Maggie called me, I was the first person in the family, and I lost it for about an hour, and I didn't want to believe that was happening. So I had to find a way to let Cheryl know, and it was hard for the kids when they showed up, and they know we've been standing with them. He wasn't just a husband to Maggie, but a brother to us. A son-in-law to my parents, always will be. We thank you for having stood with us all the way. And Andrew knows how much the whole family loved and cared for him. And you know, as we came up here today, I was talking to Ashley about the word of the Lord. And she struggled with judging versus telling people about the word of God. And we live in a politically correct society now, where only Christians get to be attacked for the word. And if we point out sin, we're attacking people. And she said, but how do you draw the line? I said, we have to live with eternity at the forefront of our thoughts, life at any moment. And I told her, had Daddy known that on that fateful Friday that he was going to leave his family, he would not have believed it. And so we have to live in a state of readiness, knowing Jesus would come anytime or we would be called up to him. But until then, what do we do in the in-between, right? And that's the question that Elijah was caught up with. The word of God. It is the word that will set us apart. It's not our titles. It is not our charisma. It is his word. The Bible says he holds his word higher than his name. And if God does that, then if we proclaim his word, then we have a standing. No matter what society says, it is the word. So Maggie, as we move forward, Cheryl and the kids, our comfort is in the word of God. That's where we run to. If we have a word, if we have the word of God, we can stand before kings. Elijah did that in front of King Ahab because he had a word. And so when we do have a word, we speak. We cannot stay silent. So I applaud you, and I know you love the Lord. Keep his word. Daddy has ran his race. Until he calls us a new home, it's his word that will guide us, right? Hebrews 4, chapter 2, says the word, it because they didn't mix the word with faith, then they were not changed. If you go read that word. So we've got to mix the word with faith, and then God will do the rest. All right? So I comfort all of you, including my family, in the word of God. Andrew ran his race. He had just finished ministry, thank Jesus. And so we're running our race. Let's run with eternity at the forefront of our thought process. We never know when we get out of the houses if we're going to get back home. So right now, as we stand and sit here, let's make Jesus the Lord of our lives. we don't know what tomorrow brings, what the next minute brings, right? It's always at a funeral that we get to think about eternity. And eternity, too many of us, because we cannot conceive the thought of death, we say we have 20 years and 30 and 40. When, like the rich man that was going to sell all his stuff and put in barns and then go sit, and Jesus said, your soul is going to be required of you tonight. So we got to be prepared and ready. This is the preparation ground. Eternity is too long to be away from the presence of God. So I call on all of you, if you don't have a relationship with Jesus, run to him today. It is not a religion. Christians are not religious people. They're relational people. Okay? That's what sets us apart from all the religions of the world. We're not looking for God. We know him because we speak to him daily. It's an ongoing relationship. And when you learn to tune into that voice of the Holy Spirit, he says, I will order your steps and direct your path. And guess what? Look at your feet. Unless you're looking down, you're not going to know the way to go. So it's a constant looking, and he's directing. And you've got to be looking, because you don't know if he's going left, right, or stay. So a walk with God, you could be driving and say, turn right, and like, ooh, Holy Spirit, I don't understand. Just do it. You don't know what's ahead. He sees ahead, and we don't see ahead. Ooh, I turned this into a song. I know. You all have to forgive me. I teach Bible study, too. So have the word of God. Let's be like the Elijah. Because the Bible says all that happened in the word was for us. Let's learn the lesson. Somebody did it. Let's not go back to it. Let's learn it so we can run our race swiftly. I love you all. I thank you for coming. And so God bless you.
Thank you, Joanne, for that. That was special. And you could have had more time. We would have given you the time, so don't worry. Okay. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. We appreciate your words and of comfort, and thank you. Thank you. I want to invite, I think, the pastor from Eagle Mountain, if I'm not wrong, is here. And after the pastor, I'd make note that Andrew had a lot of schoolmates that graduated with him this past May. I don't know if we've chosen one person to speak. If we've not, could who? Niger? Okay, so after Pastor, if Niger can move up here, please, to follow Pastor. Welcome.
Good preaching. But I'm sure this church is going to invite you back one day. You know, in the brochure, it said that Andrew was an active member of the men's ministry at Eagle Mountain International Church. And I want to talk a little bit about what that means so that everyone could understand. But Maggie, to you, your children, your family, on behalf of Eagle Mountain International Church, Kenneth Copeland Ministries, and KCBC, grace and peace be multiplied to all of you in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Amen. So, one of the things that we've been doing in the men's ministry, and Andrew has been a member, a very active member from the beginning. Andrew was a man of men, and he had men follow him within our men's ministry. We have been engaging in teaching spiritual warfare and the importance of the lifestyle of spiritual warfare. And in that, I got to meet, had the privilege of serving Andrew, and I got to meet with Andrew about engaging in that spiritual warfare for himself, for his family, for what he's believing for. And I want to share a scripture here that I think best captures Andrew's heart for other men in the men's ministry, but the type of man that the spiritual giant that Andrew was. As silent as he was a spiritual giant. So in 2 Timothy chapter 2, and I'm going to read this in the Amplified, verse 3. Take with me your share of the hardships and sufferings which you are called to endure as a good first-class soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier, when in service, gets entangled in the enterprises of civilian life. His aim is to satisfy and please the one who enlisted him. I can tell you, as a pastor, as a co-laborer with Andrew, he is a good soldier. He wore the armor of God well. His faith never wavered, and he carried that shield of faith above all. Above all, he believed, and even in his times of challenges, when he came into my office to pray things through, I felt I was ministered to when he left. He deposited faith and never wavered. And I just want those who maybe don't know this side of Andrew to understand that when it comes to a man of God being a good soldier in the army of our Lord Jesus Christ, he was a very good soldier. So it was my honor to serve him and the other leaders that are here with the men's ministry as well. And I just, Maggie, thank you for sharing him with us. He blessed us all. God bless you.
Oh, thank you, Pastor. That is good. Very, I like it when pastors get to testify and tell us what we don't know, because pastors have a lot that we talk to them about. And so thank you a lot for doing that. And the family, it's not many times that we get to know that maybe our dad or friend or brother was somebody who talked to his pastor at a personal level. And therefore, we appreciate that. So the schoolmates, Nadja? Nadja, are you here? She's not here. Okay, the schoolmates, who do you all choose? The classmates. I had one name from a number of you. Okay, thank you.
Hey, buddy. He's so cute. Precious is what the Lord told me when I was over there and looking. And I never saw her. She's so precious as well. Your whole family, she's precious over all of you. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, precious in the eyes of the Lord is in the death of his saints. And Andrew lived near me going to Bible college. We lived maybe 3 or 4 miles away. I'd pass by to go to the Lowe's and think about him. And, you know, I'm upset I never stopped in one day and got to see such a beautiful family. Was more tied up in my own problems. But Andrew always encouraged me, and just like you would encourage each and every one of you. I didn't understand any of this when this happened. And it was like, Lord, here's a guy dedicated himself to you. He moved his family here for you. he went harder than I did at this, and I know, and he was good to me every single day, and everybody there was good to me, but Andrew was, he made a point to be good to me every day. And I was not a man of many words, but it was one, had the probably the biggest impact in my life out of my classmates through all this. Now, there'll be other ones that I'm sure that we'll have to go through in the future, but Andrew didn't expect this soon. But the Lord quickened me real quick that God's word doesn't change. It's true, and it's powerful. And Andrew knew that, and you know, Andrew just coming up here today. Andrew's and right there with God right now. I came from Houston to come up here this morning. I get up. I was gonna leave at 7. I was out the door at 7:15. I was barely gonna be able to get up here and get here for the thing. I work for a flooring company, and that's kind of how Andrew and I became friends, was he had a tile business or a tile cleaning shop, I don't know, or he had some kind of business to do with something, and we talked about it. And coming up here, you know, I had a customer, his $30,000 job was going to cancel. And I saw Andrew's God, my God, our God, perform one of the biggest miracles, because my company said, we can't do it. And I said, no, can't, the customer's going to cancel. And I said, either go to Andrew's thing or go deal with this. And I said, God, with you, we can do both. And problem was, it was a shower glass in a person's house, probably 1, 2, 3 times this. I can understand 2 guys can't get that. But I need help, and I'm by myself, and I ain't had a shower yet. I just came here straight from the shower. But I said, I believed that it could be done, just like Andrew believed it can be done, and he taught me this a lot, and that, you know, God said, just go to that house, there'll be somebody there. I didn't know if he's mowing a yard or what he was doing, but when I got up there, before I got to the little neighborhood, just right down the street, it's a little 7-Eleven, I see a truck and a van, and I said, the Lord speaks, that's the truck and the van. I walk inside, I find who's the guy driving the truck and the van. Looks like it would have been you. And I said, hey, will you take this? He was like, more than capable. House is 2 blocks away, $100, take 15 minutes of your time. Just need 15 minutes. Nah. Older gentleman behind him said to me, I looked at him and I said, nah, not going to be the right guy. He's more than capable, but he's got money, he'd do it. He says, hey, I'm about to give up, walk out the door and just go see what the deal is and call it quits. And he says, what do I got to do for that $100? And I said, oh, man, you can do it. And it all worked out perfect. I said, what's your name, John? And it's just, what a great testimony for all that to get done in 15 minutes, 20 minutes. I got on the road, was able to make it here. And I didn't want to miss this because Andrew meant a lot to me. Like, I didn't know he meant a lot to you. And I wish I knew him like y'all know him. Because, man, I mean, I'll never forget him. And I'll never forget y'all. And can you repeat what you said? I thought that was so, it wasn't cheesy. It was divine.
I said, don't cry because, hang on, hello. Yeah, I said, don't cry because it's over. I said, smile because it happened. Yeah.
Love you guys.
Thank you so much. I want to say thank you to your classmates for choosing you. I think that was a good representation of the class, and thank you. We were going to move to the next person, Sinead Toll. Sinead Toll is a childhood friend of Andrew. So it's good to have friends that could stand with us throughout life. And so Sinead, please, if you may.
First, I'd like to thank the good Lord for giving us this opportunity to meet here and say farewell to our brother, Andrew. I also want to thank Reverend Dan Correll and First Lady Susan for all that you have done for us to be here to say farewell. We say thank you. Thank you. I can stand here right now and say to be strong. But it's a difficult thing to do. I try, you've heard that I'm the childhood friend, neighbor. It's been very difficult for me, so bear with me. We'll get through this together. I'm here with my family, my wife, Dr. Honey, my father-in-law, and my mother-in-law. They have been, you know. I also want to take this time for say, Pole, sorry to the family, to the kids. I want to say very sorry. It's difficult, but we'll get through it. Sorry. I also want to take you back now to the childhood, growing up with Andrew back in Kenya. We are actually immediate neighbors back in Kenya in a small town called Chepsir. Yeah, so Africa, if people still show up at your doorstep, they don't have to call, they don't have to say anything, they just show up. Or you just say, oh, let me go and say hi to my friend. I don't want to know even I'm going to be around. I just go and ask, is Andrew around? Hey. Or who's I'll just go there and just, yeah. That's the kind of strong network that people have. Even here, too, I'm sure there are some places where you go, and in the rural areas where things like this still happen. But for those who know Andrew's family, Andrew did not miss anything. Growing up, he had the best. They had everything. But there's one thing about Andrew that I'll tell you. He always wanted to get his own. He wanted to build his family on his own. He wanted to do everything on his own. Every time, he's like, hey, you need help? No, I got it. Even though maybe he was struggling or something, he would still say, no, I got it. I'll do it on my own. So every time I would travel to Kenya, I'll visit the family, the dad, the mom. And all the time they would ask me, when you go back to America, please ask him if he can relocate back home to help me with his businesses, his everything. And when I come back to the US, I'll call Andrew. I'll approach him and I'll pass the message. Obviously, he was communicating with the family, I know. But it made it very personal, coming from the dad and being the neighbor, that, hey, you need to come back home and help me. I'm getting old. All these things, I need to, businesses, there'll be nobody to run. You come, bring all the experiences from America and come and help me here. And this time I came about 3 years or 4 years ago, I passed a message to him. And he told me the same thing I know. No, I have my family here. I want to take care of my family. I'll go home when I'm ready. Well, he wasn't very, very happy about the fact that the family back home was pressuring him to relocate back to Kenya, or to, you know, it felt like he was. He also felt that I was also pushing him too much. And I think he stepped back a little bit, you know, from talking to me. I'll call him and call him and call him. But today, I want to take this opportunity to say, Andrew, I'm sorry. If I ever did anything to you, I'm sorry. For some of us who have remained here, we want to continue to give the support to the family, Margaret, and the children, Ryan, and all the children. Let's be there for them in support. I know it's difficult, but to have time in America sometimes is very difficult. You can, you know, have a jungle in our own businesses and everything, but let's take time to call and give any support that we can to them as they are grieving and going through all this. Thank you so much. I want to say more, but as I said earlier on, it's very difficult for me today. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you, Brother Sine. I will, on behalf of everybody else, I'll say, well, I know Andrew understood and meant, he knew you meant well. So thanks for bringing that up. And so the family wanted to make sure that we did not overlook anyone who may have wanted to say something. So they asked that we open for two people, anyone at large, who may want to say something. Yes, please. I saw a hand go up there. Anyone else after she does it? One more person, yes. Okay, I'll give the three, that's fine. I saw three hands, so ma'am, please. And then I'll give you, I don't want to say you, but I don't know your name, but I'll ask you, and then I'll ask him. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I wanted to say, I met Andrew at church, Eagle Mountain International Church, and I introduced myself to him. I hadn't met Maggie yet, but while we were attending the classes, the Lord just put on my heart that I should treat him as though he was one of my own. I called my son and I told my son about him, and I introduced them. And those two, they had basically the same kind of personality, quiet, strong. You can really depend upon them. If you call them and ask them to do something, you know it's already done. And they got along so well. They spoke for a long time. I remember when my daughter-in-law came for Thanksgiving. I'm a person that used to have everything in order and control. But at that time, things were just going so much. I had just gotten over the death of my mom and my sister. And my daughter-in-law went into labor at the house. And I remember praying for her because the baby was early. And I called Andrew and Maggie and asked them to agree with me in prayer, as did my son. Well, they went to the hospital the next morning, the baby was born. The baby was never in an incubator, nothing. The baby is fine. She's almost a year and a half now. But Andrew touched my heart. He always listened to my advice. I could always ask him anything, ask his opinion about anything. And I always tell him, I will talk with you. I say, I'll talk with you and Maggie together, never apart. have to be together because I'm doing the same as my mother did. She'll never talk to me about my husband without him being there, unless he was out of the country. And she did the same thing with my other children. So I just wanted to say it was a pleasure for me to meet Andrew. When I got the news, I thought it was someone else that they told me had passed. And when I understood it was him, I sat down and my heart became very heavy. And all of a sudden I heard the Holy Spirit say, "He's home. I don't want you to take this on like you did with your mom and your sister. I want you to be happy for them." So every time I am tempted to get really sad, I just start praying, as Brother Kenneth say, his mama always say, I mean Pastor Terry say, her grandmother always say, hidden in tongues, and that's what I do. It was hard for me to get here today. I was getting ready to leave, and I had this big water spill in the kitchen. Could not understand why that happened. And I say, you know what? Lord, just help me to, you know, suck up most of it and just leave it, because I'm not missing this funeral today. My son and his wife couldn't come, but I'm here just to say we love Andrew as one of our own, and I'll always remember him. And to me, I didn't want to see the body lay out. I just want to remember him the last time I saw him and what he said to me. And I thank everybody for coming. Thank you.
I got better acquainted with Andrew when we went on a short-term missionary trip to New Orleans. And so kind. And you know where he's at today. And if he could say anything to you, he'd say, "Have great. Whatever you do, don't miss it."
God is good all the time. My name is Elias Sudoi. I know Andrew from way, way back. I went to primary school with him way back in 1989. That is when we graduated primary school. And when my brother Justice called me and told me that Andrew had passed, even though I'd not seen him for such a long time, you know when you just know somebody, you know them. You haven't seen them for so long, but you're still, you know their presence. And I was in shock that had happened. And I just wanted to, I want to pass my condolences to this family. We are praying for you. I normally commune with the Catholic community, the Kenyan Catholic community of Dallas and Fort Worth. I would like to pass our condolences. And I'm glad that I heard that Andrew was very active with the men. I'm the chairman of the Kenyan Catholic Men's Association. And I think I'm very proud that he was doing that for the men and the church. So that tells you that he's in a very good place right now. And the Bible tells us that we walk by faith and not by sight, right? So, and that is why we believe in the promise that Christ gave us and said that he's going to prepare a place for us, right? If we do not have that faith, we would not be here. And we are not forsaken that Andrew has left us. But we celebrate him. We celebrate his life. And I just want to say pole sana to you guys. Pole sana to my Houston family for losing him. And we'll continue praying for one another. Let us continue praying for one another, because within our community we are losing our loved ones. And when I see Andrew is me, right? I grew up with him. So that means that we really need to continue praying for one another and holding each other in prayer and always being there to support one another. So rest in peace, my brother. God bless you. God be with you and God be with his family. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for I lost both of them. Okay, this is back. Thank you. Well, thank you so much, the volunteers. I appreciate you. Didn't know you were on the program. And thank you, the family, for opening up. We didn't want to leave anybody out on that. Right now, we have on your bulletin, we have selection number two. And selection number two in your bulletins, I'll invite the praise team to lead us on that, please.
Shall we stand, please? The song is in Swahili. It translates in English to "My hope is built on nothing else but the blood of Jesus."
Kuziosha chaku tumaini sina ila damu yake Bwana sina wema wa kutosha dhambi zangu kuziosha. Yeah.
may be seated, please. Thank you, the praise team, for taking us through that beautiful song. It's the right place for us to transition to a sermon and an encouragement for the family. But before I invite Reverend Dr. Daniel Correa to come up, I want to take a personal note to thank him for opening the church for us. When this happened, or when Andrew was called home, I personally know the wife's family and the sisters more than Andrew. And so I called you at night quite late. And I said, we've had a loss in the family. And the family is new in town. They have not interacted much with our community. I happen to be one person that has almost every pastor's number in the Metroplex. And not all of them do answer my call at night. And so that night when you answered very late and I knew to call you, and I want to say it's not always true that people come to help and to pray for families in such a time as this, especially when you didn't know them to attend your church. So I say that to say that, as I said at the very beginning, just maybe you've been put in this place for such times as this. And therefore, as a church, I will say, when another call comes at night, answer it, as surely they will come. And therefore, I want to invite him to say a word and to carry us through the sermon and to solidify what we've heard about the God of Andrew, so that today, as he speaks up here, we can say, we therefore know the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, and the God of Andrew. Pastor.
Praise God. Let me take this opportunity to thank God for this afternoon. I want to thank him for, I know nothing takes God by surprise. Dr. Bora just mentioned, for such a time as this, he knew that at such a time, on a day like today, you would be here. And for our brother Andrew, nothing takes God by surprise. So let me take this chance to welcome all of you, to say this is Ushindi International Fellowship Church. We honor the Lord for giving us the opportunity to come and celebrate the man of God that is here with us today. And we want to thank God for this opportunity. For the family, Maggie and your children, Ashley, Noah, Zoe, and Ryan. Yes, thank you. Receive our condolences. Rhoda, thank you so much for traveling in and putting all this together. I think in my face, you are the one who has put all this together. And if anybody has taken for granted, I will note that you have traveled all the way across from Delaware, I think. From Delaware, came to DFW and ran up and down. Yesterday, when I was asking if she has made the program, and she's like, oh no, we have not made the program because we had to go view the body and we have to go do this and the other one, and I felt so bad. And I want to thank you for such a big hug. Thank you again for, you know, the what the last couple of days or week has been really rough, but we want to thank God because, you know, you've had the grace to bear through this. For Eagle Mountain Church, what a great privilege. When I read, I never had a privilege to meet with Andrew, but when I read his testimony and his walk with God, that was more than enough. And again, you have done a wonderful job allowing him to fellowship in your church and to interact with the men in your ministry. It's a great thing that he has left behind. So from me, from myself, from my family, from our church, we want to say receive our condolences. We thank God for the life that Andrew has shared with us. And I want to pray that even as we are going to read that scripture this afternoon, I know he is going to bless you. You know, there are so many things that have been mentioned about him that any one of us can take home and change your life and bless your life and help you to build good memories. There is one of the ladies that just came here and said, I looked at him like one of my own. Why? Because he probably had something special. And this afternoon, we want to celebrate that special trait that he had, and we bless God together. I would not want to continue so much on that part, but I want to go straight to the scripture. And before I do that, just talk to somebody next to you. Tell them there is hope. Not just hope, beyond the grave. Praise God. And let's read from the book of Deuteronomy. I want to quickly just cover something interesting here. This is about Moses. The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 34. And from verse 1, the Bible says, then Moses climbed Mount Nebo from the plains of Moab to the top of Pisgah, across from Jericho. There, the Lord showed him the whole land from Gilead to Dan, keep going, all of Naphtali, the territory of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the Mediterranean Sea. Keep going. The Negev and the whole region from the valley of Jericho, the city of Sams, as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to him, this is the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob when I said, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you will not cross over into it. I can just go to the last one, verse 5. And Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in Moab, as the Lord had said. I want to thank God for this afternoon. Let's pray. Father, you are faithful. Father, you are gracious this afternoon. We thank you for this opportunity to come and witness and share and encourage and bless you for the promises that come upon your children when they wait upon you. We thank you and we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. I will not spend so much time, but I just want to build something in you this afternoon, that you may be wondering why I am bringing the story of Moses, and I'm sure we will see where our brother Andrew comes in. So Moses, just to give you a highlight, was born in a prophetic way. He walked in the plans of God all his life. You will remember the story of the little manger that he was in the sea. You will remember the wilderness experience. You will remember the palace and the palace experience and his battle with the royalty and how he fled to the wilderness and how he stayed as a servant of somebody in the desert for 40 years and how he came back and he delivered the children of Israel. But to say that is not to give you a full preview of Moses' life. But the pinnacle of it happens when God comes and says, now let me take you. He took him to Mount Nebo, a very high mountain, and he saw everything. He saw everything, but he never lived beyond to see it. In other words, God was telling him, even though your life is ending here, my promises are not ending at this point. I am showing you that even though you will not live to see what I have promised, I am a God of hope for those who hope in me. So they will not see you cross over, but they will get there. This gentleman, Andrew, is here. And here we are crying and mourning. But this let has to be a reminder that there is hope beyond here. Hallelujah. I want to thank God because he can allow you to climb the mountain of life. You know, he comes from a very famous family back home. You know, if nobody knew their family, then you probably came from a different place because they were quite famous, and you know they were successful in every way, if you may say so. And some of us are probably like that. You have climbed the mountain of life. Talk about your economic ladder. You have climbed it all. Talk about influence. You have climbed it all. You talk about fame, you may have climbed it all. You talk about your academic ladder, you may have climbed it all. But is that enough? Moses lived all that. And still God said, you may have overcome a lot of the challenges in life, but still I have something beyond here. You know, when he stood in the mountain and, you know, and he looked, I can imagine, you know, you can stand and you can see everywhere. If you know the map of the world, now that we know because of the modern science, you know, you can see everywhere, all the way from Egypt, like the Bible says, to the far side of the Arabian Peninsula. And in one place, and God says, now this is where things are. This is where life is. Mainly because God has a promise for every one of us. I want you to challenge yourself to get to know this, that God has a promise for you no matter what you are going through. He has a promise for you. You know, many times we are so impatient. We want to see things happen like now, quickly, quickly. But it is not like that. God has a promise somehow. Are you patient enough to wait on him? The Bible says that them that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. If you are patient enough, you will witness the promises of God in your life. I have challenged myself so much to wait on him because many times, just like everybody else, you are so impatient, you want to get things like quickly. But he is a God who wants us to wait. I'm sure Moses would have been like, I want to see this promised land. How can you let me struggle for 40 years in the desert, wandering about with these people, waiting upon a promise that we are looking forward to, and you never let me get to see it. You never get to let me get to experience it. You know, we hear there are big men and great giants in that land. We hear the land is flowing with milk and honey. I want to taste it. But God says, it may tarry, but wait on it. It shall surely come to pass. And, you know, of course, many of us, especially with, you know, with the modern science that, you know, that has advanced so greatly, like you can graft one organ from here, from you, and put it on the other person, and they continue to live. And we want to live forever. Many of us, if I can ask, if deep down within you, you never want to die. Every one of us never, even at 125 years, if you happen to, you still want to continue living. You know, while I was preparing this message, I saw one of the TV icons, Simon Cowell, one of the presenters of America's Got Talent, and I believe X Factor before. And one of the things that caught my attention was he says, when he dies, he wants to be preserved. So that maybe one day, one time, the scientists will put things together and be able to reverse and bring you back to life. He says, maybe 300 years down the line, something may happen, and I don't want to miss out. This tells you what innately lies within many of us, that you never want to die. Deep, deep down within you somehow, you want to live and never die. And, you know, one of the things that God has put in place that scientists have never got to understand is how people age. And how, you know, today you are, your skin is so smooth and so succulent, and tomorrow it is shrinkled and shriveled. And today you are so springy and you can jump as high as 5 feet high, and tomorrow you can barely lift a foot. You know, today your skin is so elastic you can stretch yourself, and tomorrow you need a massage to keep things functioning. You know, you never get to understand. And they get to say, you see, there is something called, let me teach you something. I'm a scientist by training. Let me teach you something. There is something called apoptosis, and there is something called necrosis. One of them is, apoptosis is something that is called a cell death by programming. You can arrange for death to die in their own natural way. And that is how we are wired. Things die naturally. And that is how we don't have cancer. Because when cancer comes in, it's because things have gone haywire. They are just growing and growing and growing and never dying. But necrosis is when things just all of a sudden quickly die. One of the things that God has put in place is that apoptosis, that things die and wither naturally. That is why the Bible says, today we are like flowers, and in the evening we wither down, and we are never alive the next day. That is how we are wired. But somehow people like this gentleman, Simon Cowell, they believe that scientists somehow, one way, they will put things backwards at some point, and you never want to miss. Have you met people who never want to miss out on anything? This is where many of us come in. That we never want to, you know, we never want to wear down. We want to remain forever strong. Talk to sportsmen and they will tell you, I want to play soccer forever. Talk to basketball players and they will tell you, I want to play until I cannot play anymore. Talk to baseball players and they will tell you, I want to be as active as I can be. Talk to any sportsman and they will tell you that I want to live and live and live and live and live. But that is the human understanding. The human, they want to understand things the human way. But talk to a child of God and they will tell you this. Even though they die, yet shall he live again. Isn't that what Jesus said? So our eyes, our carnal eyes, they look at things that we can see. That is why you go to that closet and you look at yourself and say, that wrinkle, I want to get rid of it. You know, that little thing there over there, I want to get rid of it, because you are working so hard behind the scenes to unprogram things that God has put in place. You know, a few years ago, I never would read without glasses. Today, I cannot without them. You know what that tells you? That tells you your clock is ticking. When you can walk and run and sprinkle and do all those things, it tells you that your apoptotic process is going on gradually. And somehow one day you will go the way like our brother has gone. But the most beautiful news that I have is there is hope for every one of us beyond today. Beyond this time. Beyond tomorrow. The Bible says in the book of Colossians, chapter 3 and verse 3. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 3, if you can add the media. Colossians. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 3, the Bible says, for you died and your life is now hidden in Christ Jesus. This is what you understand as a child of God. that people like Simon Cowell do not in their own eyes. Because when your life is hidden in God, you have hope beyond the grave. Hallelujah. The book of John chapter 5 and verse 21 says, the Father raises the dead and makes them to have life. It is God who makes you to have life. That is why Jesus said, even though they die, yet shall he live again. Even though we grieve today, even though we are sad today, there is hope beyond the casket. The book of Ecclesiastes chapter 9 and verse 5 again gives us a very good emphasis. It says, the living know that one day they will die. That is why scientists are working things behind the scenes and working around the clock. The living know that one day they will die, but the dead know nothing. They have no further reward, and even their name is forgotten. And this is where the child of God comes in. That in order for you to remain immortal, the way Moses was, the Bible says that God buried him somewhere where nobody knows. Your immortality is characterized by what you leave behind. You know, I heard the son say that, you know, by the things that my father told me. You know, I was thinking about this today. That this being a Father's Day weekend, what a great way to honor a man of God who fears the Lord as a great father, as a wonderful father of four children. And I pray that he has left something behind for you. That you will look back and say, this is what my father taught me. He never told me to do what is not right. He never told me to close a door on a hopeless person. He never taught me to be unkind to those that need kindness. He never taught me to not show love to those that need love. But he showed you to even give them a smile when they have none. To give them hope when they have none. To give them encouragement when they have none. To love one and to love all equally, in equal measure. Because Christ, the Bible says, is love. But now here's a different situation. You know, Moses, as the children of Israel knew, was a great man who God says he spoke to him face to face. Who the Bible says that he was the most humble man in the world of his time. Who they say was a man who God would show up and his face would shine because of the glory of God in his face. And yet, when he dies, there is so much pain, the Bible says. If you go to verse 5 of that book of Deuteronomy, verse 6 actually, Deuteronomy chapter 34 and verse 6. Actually, 8, verse 8, sorry. Deuteronomy 34 and verse 8. Where the Bible says that the Israelites grieved for Moses in the plains of Moab for 30 days until the time of weeping and mourning was over. And this is the message for the family. It is okay to grieve. It is okay to be sad when you lose a loved one. I have seen many instances in the scriptures where even the man of God, who everybody knew was in the presence of the Lord, they still had a chance to mourn him. The Bible talks about Moses. They mourned him. The Bible says they cried to God, celebrating his life and grieving over what they were going to miss for what Moses had done for them. Do you remember a time when Moses was so angry with the children of Israel, he came and he smashed every idol that they had built. And still when he passed away, they grieved him. Lazarus, the Bible says, in the book of John, chapter 11 and verse 35, the Bible says that when Lazarus died, Jesus came. And looking at how much the family was affected, he grieved with them. And the Bible says, Jesus wept. So the family, we want to encourage you that God has created us to be relational. I think she did a very wonderful part of my sermon today. Said that God has wired us to be relational. One of the things that you are going to miss is the company at the table, the picnics that you probably could go, the vacations that you could go, the players that they could go with the children and things like that. And this is where grieving comes in. And it is okay to do that. And the reason why we grieve is because God has wired us to interact one to another. That is what the Bible calls fellowship. God has created us to fellowship with one another. And when that fellowship is broken, sadness comes in. Grieving comes in. Crying comes in. Wailing comes in. Mourning comes in. So Jesus wept because Lazarus, his friend, had passed away. And the Bible says the same thing of Stephen in the book of Acts chapter 8 and verse 2. Stephen was a man who was so much full of wisdom and faith that when he stood, the Bible says that they could not withstand the wisdom by which he spoke. So when they stoned him to death, the Bible says that after he was buried, the church grieved for him. They felt bad, they felt sad for the loss of Stephen. And Job gave us a beautiful classic example in Job chapter 1 and verse 21. Give me that book, Job chapter 1 and verse 21. I want to show you three beautiful truths that are very applicable to us in this situation. And Job chapter 1 and verse 21, the Bible says, and he said, naked I came from my father's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken. Praise be to the name of the Lord. Let me show you three truths. Number one, the Lord gives. Everybody wants to receive. If God was able to deliver a brand new car to your door tomorrow, you will be so happy. If God gave you the biggest miracle tomorrow, you will be the happiest person. Have you seen those people who, out of nowhere, in a stage 4 cancer situation, they turn around and all of a sudden they have their life back and they will never stop talking about that? A breakthrough. Everybody wants to receive. Tomorrow you wake up and there is $1 million in your account, you will be the happiest person. Before you ask where it came from, you will have thrown it fast and put it somewhere else safe. And then you ask later, questions later. Take it fast and questions later. So that is what we love to do. When this gentleman, Andrew, was born, I'm sure everybody was happy. His parents were happy. His classmates were happy in school. His siblings were happy. Later on, his wife was happy. Everybody is happy that he is here. But then now, the Bible says, the Lord has taken away. Nobody wants to lose whatever they have. Have you ever seen people who hoard that, you know, you go and buy something at the store, there is the package, even you want to keep the package plus the cup. You know, you go and buy the bread and you want to never want to get rid of the package because of the, you know, of the container because it looks nice. Because you want to keep and keep and keep and keep and keep, the more you have. And then when we come to your garage, we see a lot of things and then we ask you, why do you keep all this? I will find a use for them one day. Because everybody wants to keep. But when you lose, it becomes a problem. Nobody wants to lose anything. Except weight, of course. Praise God. You know, if you want to ever want to be the biggest loser, I'm sure one of them is the weight. But I want to thank God because he says nobody, not many people would want to lose anything. For whatever reason, we want to keep what we have. So, and this is what is happening here. We don't want to lose, you know, a great man who would be a great encourager. Sometimes even people who are quiet, they are also good in their own way. They are great listeners. They provide great answers. But they don't bubble like everybody else. And, you know, my understanding is this gentleman was a very, you know, very humble guy and very quiet and you know, doesn't say much. But still, he had great value to men's ministry, to his family, to his children, to his community, to his family back home, who is saying, we want him to come back and we want him to do this and we want to, you know. The real thing here is we never want to lose. And then there is one final thing, one final truth. Praise be to the name of the Lord. You know, the Bible says, give thanks to God in all. Does it say when you get, when you receive? Does it say, does the Bible say that when you receive something, just only give praise and give thanks to God at such a moment? Give thanks to Him in all things. When you receive, give thanks. When you lose, give thanks. When a child is born, give thanks. When the same child passes away, give thanks. Give thanks in all things. And Job says, I want to give praise to God. And this is the man who lost everything. He lost his 7 children. He lost his sheep. He lost his camels. He lost his wealth. He lost his everything. Even his friends he lost. But still he said, praise be to the name of the Lord. And the same thing to the family. We say this to you. We say this to you. Give praise to God for the testimony that He has left behind. Give praise to God for the character that He carried Himself with, the great demeanor that He carried Himself with, because this will live beyond Him. Now, finally, the real enemy here is the biggest elephant in the house. The real enemy is death. Everybody wants to evade death. But I want to thank God, because the Bible says that your enemy, the adversary, is prowling around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. But the same Bible goes ahead to say in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 26, it says the last enemy to be destroyed is death. Death itself. Any death that is happening in between here is not the final one. It will happen. It just happened to Andrew a few days ago. It will happen in the near future to somebody else, and it will happen to somebody else in the future. It will happen to somebody else in the future, and it keeps going on and on and on and on. But the final blow that will happen is in that book of 1 Corinthians. And that is the hope of every child of God. That is the encouragement to every child of God. You know, I keep reading this book, Psalms 23, and there are so many beautiful revelations that you see in that book. Let me show you one. The book of Psalms chapter 23 and verse 4. The Bible says, even though I walk through the darkest valley, some versions call it the valley of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, and your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, so let me show you. God has not limited you from going to certain places, including the valley. When you get to the lowest point in life, it is not unusual. When you get to the lowest part of your journey, it is not the end of it. The enemy could still be there. Even walking through the darkest part of life that takes you through death itself. And the Bible says, that enemy, the last enemy that will be destroyed, death, is not the final thing. Finally, one day, one time, God is going to wipe your tears. God is going to wipe and remove every sorrow that has ever happened in your heart. And the Bible says, Psalms chapter 30 and verse 5. And the Bible says that weeping may endure a night, but joy comes in the morning. This is the hope for every child of God, that joy comes in the morning. Morning is not necessarily the next date on the calendar. Morning may not necessarily be next week or next year, but morning is the time when the final trumpet of God shall sound, and every righteous saint is going to awake and will hear that voice. This is probably one of those days that you will get to see and experience your brother again, your husband again, your dad again, the loved one that you may have lost, because God has planned that one day, one time, there is going to be some rejoicing in the morning that the Lord has prepared. I want to pray for the family. And I want to thank God because I know God is faithful. You know, one of the things that happened to the children of Israel when Moses received the calling was, I have heard their cries and I have come to deliver them. And this afternoon, the same God who wiped the tears of the children of Israel after 430 years is still here to wipe your tears when you are grieving. The same God that saw Moses through every difficulty in life at his time is still here this morning. The same God that Abraham was so waiting for, the city that God had prepared, is still here to encourage you this afternoon. I want to pray for you. And you might be saying, Pastor, I pray that God turns my life around and let me give my life to him this afternoon. I want to pray for you as well. Even those online as well, I want to thank God because you are there listening. This may be the time that you may have been waiting for, because God, our God is faithful. And I want to pray first, beginning with the family. And if you are there as well and you are saying, I want to receive this Jesus for the first time, and just believe it in your heart. The Bible says that when you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. Let me request the family to come up front here, and then I'll pray for you. Then we'll go from there. Every family member, and you know, I can imagine that there's quite a number of, not just the immediate family, the whole family that came to the office, and any other family member that we want to pray for you. And again, just line up here. And I will request Andrew's pastor as well to come up front here so that we can pray. And any other pastor that might be here today, just come forward. We'll pray for you together in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't be afraid. Just come forward. Just come closer and line up here. And we are going to pray together with Pastor. Pastor Al. Yes, so we are going to pray together with Pastor Al, a prayer of blessing upon the family. And we want to thank God. And there's also the pastor who went to school together with him. Is he a pastor? You can come forward and we can pray together with him. Any pastor that is here, just come forward. We'll pray together in Jesus' name. This is the place let me have the other mic. This is the place where we can speak a blessing upon you. We can pray that the Lord is going to comfort you. We know the challenges may be enormous. The thinking is frozen. You may not know what comes next. But I want to thank God, because he is there to meet you at the point of your need, to comfort you, to wipe your tears, and to bless you. So I'm going to request Pastor Al. He is going to pray for the family, that the Lord will comfort them, that the Lord will sustain them, that the Lord will keep them through this process. And then the other pastor, I don't know. Pastor Stephen, just also pray for whatever is coming up next, that the Lord is going to go ahead of them, that the Lord may continue to guide and lead the family. And I'll close in Jesus' name. For the rest of us, let's just hold hands together and believe that the Lord is going to do an amazing thing, that the Lord is going to bless them, that the Lord is going to see them through in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for your most Holy Spirit, the Comforter.
Yes.
Lord, and by your Spirit, we thank you that the peace that surpasses all understanding, that surpasses the mind, be upon Andrew's family right now. Father God, the peace that extends beyond any understanding that we have in our own minds, in our own hearts. Father, the peace that only your Spirit can provide. Father, I thank you that we can go in the peace of God, that we can grow in the peace of God, knowing that Andrew has defeated death and he's entered into an everlasting life with our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we look at our end from our beginning. And we thank you, Lord, that we have the same opportunity one day to run this most precious race, this gift of life that you've given us, Father, and Lord, and to cross over, not in any death that's final, Father, but to cross over as Andrew did. And we rest in the knowledge of that understanding. And let that peace extend to the hearts and souls of everybody here. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you. Amen.
Amen.
And Father, we just we thank you, Lord, that you guide and direct their path, Father, that everywhere that they go, Father God, that you be in front of them, and that they follow your footsteps, Lord, and that no matter where they end up, Father God, but they end up in your path, and the path that they follow is your path, Father God, that they do not stray, Father God, and when they just go to a little bit to the left or the right, that they be right on the middle of where you have them, Lord.
Yes.
That, Father, when they're searching and they're looking for what's next and how do I get to this and how do I get to that,
yes,
that they see you and they see your hand and that you're guiding them and that your hand is on their life, Father God, and that they're instructed internally and physically, Father God, by you. And we just give you thanks, Lord. And we just thank you, Father, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, you are a great God this afternoon. You are the Lord of all comfort that we seek this afternoon. Father, we seek your blessing upon this family. We seek your comfort upon them. You said, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. We thank you for comforting them, O God. We thank you for helping them even cope through this. Thank you for wiping their tears. Thank you, Lord, for giving them the peace that surpasses all understanding. Father, we confess of your greatness. We confess that you are a God of provision. We thank you because you have provided them, O God, with the peace. You have provided them with the comfort, even with the financial support that they have needed. We thank you, King of Glory, that you have walked them through every path that they have been until here today. You are a wonderful God. You still remain to be God. You still remain to be faithful. You are still seated on that throne. We bless you this afternoon. You have said in your word that those who believe, even though they die, yet shall they live again. We thank you because there is hope beyond the grave. We thank you because you have provided, oh God, you are a God of promise. You have promised us eternal life. And by faith, we believe that it is our portion in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Thank you for your goodness. Stand with all of us. Encourage us, oh God. Let that morning of rejoicing and joy be this moment that we can celebrate of your goodness. Even as we have seen your servant come home to you. We bless you this afternoon. We honor you. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much, family. Thank you so much, pastors. May you, amen. Amen.
Again, thank you, Pastor Dan. Thank you again. Appreciate that. We're going to invite the praise team to sing one song, and I'll ask Sister Rhoda to be ready to give a vote of thanks after the song. So if the praise team can come up, we'll sing a Swahili song, Pamoja na Wewe, translated together with you. We can stand with them and sing the song with them. Mm. may be seated, please.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you so much. I know so much has been said up here, and so much time has gone, but we are full. We are full, we are full, we are full. We are full of thanks. Thank you is a it's two words, right? Used, sometimes overused so much, but today I just want you to know that the word thank you means so much coming from our family. So I'm going to actually read my vote of thanks. Otherwise, I'm just going to go on, and then you'll be like, nope, she needs to stop. So, all right. So I want to greet you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Rhoda Harrell, and I am Maggie's big sister. She's only a year younger than me. So, and thank you so much for coming to join us in celebrating the life of Andrew and being with the family to comfort and encourage us. First, I want to begin by sharing about a special call we received yesterday from the nurse that cared for Andrew the night before he was discharged to come home. She had been looking for our contact information so she could speak with Maggie. She was in tears as she narrated the hours she spent caring for Andrew on Wednesday night, a day after the surgery. She said he was in a prayerful and worshipful mood, spent time listening to worship music and sermons pretty much most of the night. She said Andrew shared with her about his life and how much he loved his children and wanted them to follow Christ. He also wanted to follow the leading of the Lord. He spoke about his aging dad and how he wanted to spend time with him. This nurse, and her name happens to be Faith, this nurse said she prayed with him and believed that Andrew had a change in his life that night. She was so saddened to hear he had passed away. I believe Andrew had an encounter with the Lord that night, and the Lord was preparing to bring him to glory, to a place the Bible calls far better, much, much far better than we can imagine. We thank the nurse for calling us and sharing the events of that night. We know he is truly home with the Lord Jesus. I would like to thank my sister, my baby sister Maggie, for the beautiful and courageous woman you are. Maggie is reserved and quiet, but I've witnessed a strength in her I have seen in no one else. She stood by Andrew through mountains and valleys. She is a great example of a Proverbs 31 woman, a godly woman who knows the throne of grace and mercy and lives her life loving her Lord and Savior. What a blessing it is to be your big sister. At the forefront, I want to thank the Ushindi Church and their amazing shepherd, Reverend Dr. Korir, and his lovely First Lady, Susan Korir. You have welcomed us with open arms and embraced us during this difficult moment. Reverend Korir, you did not even know us, I guess from Adam, as they say, but you took us as one of your own. You spent many hours of your precious time assisting us in so many ways to make this celebration a success. You lightened the load by allowing the Lord to use you. You and your amazing church are the hands and feet of Jesus, and you live up to your church name, Ushindi or Victory. We feel victorious today because of Christ's work in your life and your congregation. So thank you, and God bless you. Secondly, I want to thank Dr. Sammy Bore for guiding us. You are family, Sammy, you are. You were the first to come and be with us and guide us through this process. In fact, the night he called Dr. Korir, Reverend Dr. Korir, we were at my uncle's house. And I said, don't call him, it's already 10, he's sleeping. And she said, well, he'll answer the call. And just as a testament to the friendship that both of you have. So thank you so much. And that's God's work. That is God's work. Sammy, Dr. Bore, you guided us throughout this entire process, even connecting us with Dr. Korir, and together you have moved mountains for us. There are members of Ushindi who are childhood friends of Andrew and Maggie, Sine Tor, who spoke up here, his wife, Dr. Honey. Thank you for the amazing support. You have both taken time and resources to help us and make this celebration befitting to our brother. Thank you both, and God bless you abundantly. What can I say to the Dallas-Fort Worth community for embracing us and providing support that we could only have dreamed of? We are eternally grateful to each and every one of you, and may God bless you. Thank you to the group of individuals that came together very quickly to start a committee, to begin organizing for the funeral. These brothers and sisters took time to meet, in the evenings, sometimes late into the night, and I want to thank you all. They were led by my amazing and truly supportive husband, Pastor Sam Harrell of Bethesda United Methodist Church in Middletown, Delaware. I want to thank you, Pastor Sam, for holding down the fort while I have spent time with my sister. The following individuals I know are not present, but they can hear us because they are watching live stream. Nash and Rabbi Birgen, Eliza and Eric Brickle, Mary and Sam Melly, Joe and Maxine Sige, Joanne Kagezi, Sambai Rono, Ernest Sang, Dr. Honey, Sine, Roby, and my sister Paris, and Sarah Koske Sile. Thank you so much for taking the time to help us plan for Andrew's final journey. Thank you so, so much to many, many childhood friends from Kericho Primary as a whole, Nandi Hills, Eldoret, and the entire Kenya. God bless you all. The administration, administrators of the group that we started so we could do the fundraiser, Edwin Bitt, Ernest Sang, Joanne Kagezi, Magdalene Langat, my sister Paris, Richard Tonui, Sambai Rono, Sarah Sile, and Sine Kaptich, Sineto. Thank you so much. Thank you to the entire Kenyan diaspora for standing with us. We truly appreciate your prayers, messages of comfort, the financial support. This is truly sacrificial giving, and all I can say is may the Lord bless you and provide for all your needs. May you never lack nothing. May your cup runneth over, and please know this, you have made a difference in our lives and brought encouragement and support to Maggie and the family. She was able to rest a little easier because of your support. I want to thank all our families. First, my aunt and uncle, Dr. Zach and Edna Yabs, and my cousins, Michael, Margaret, and Melanie of Frisco, Texas, for the strong foundation we needed during this time. You opened up your home and asked us to use it as a base to begin the plans. You warmly welcomed visitors who came to visit with Maggie. May God bless you, auntie and uncle. To my sister, Paris, Paris is younger than Maggie. You truly are an amazing sister and auntie. You have juggled work and being with us from day one. Paris will be traveling with Maggie and the children to Kenya, and I appreciate her show of love to all of us. To all my relatives and cousin in the U.S. who came and to be with us and showed support, Uncle Dr. Jonathan Katam of Oklahoma, my in-laws, the Mayos of Delaware, my sister-in-law, Elena Harrell, who is here, another sister-in-law, Kia, who is here, my cousins, the Kibors, the Katams, the Kiruis, the Sangs, the Togoches, we are so grateful for your support and love. Thank you to the Suge family in Kericho, led by Leonard Suge, and to the entire Kipia family, led by my parents. You have all been amazing in coming together and supporting Maggie and the children. To the entire Mutai family, thank you for the love and unity you have shown to Maggie. You took time to drive many, many hours so we could all be together and to begin the journey. That we have accomplished much. We will continue to stay united and protect and support Andrew's legacy, his children. Ashley and Ryan, we love you very much, and Maggie welcomes you anytime. To Ernest Sang, Andrew's first cousin, you have been my brother. Thank you for being the family rep and communicating with Kericho and for spending many, many hours brainstorming with me. I thank your wife and children for standing by you. Thank you to the Nganga family and Bedford Memorial Funeral Home for the great work you are doing and for the professional services we have received. We appreciate your patience, guidance, and support. If I have forgotten anyone, please hold it against my head and not my head. I lack words to describe what I have witnessed these last few days. The love and support we have received cannot be described. May the Lord bless you all, and may He smile upon you all the days of your life. Thank you so, so, so much.
Thank you all for staying with us. I know we're coming to the end of it. I'll invite Reverend Dr. Corey again to do the benediction, And after the benediction, I invite the Bedford Funeral Home staff to take the next stage. So after the benediction, we will go straight to the viewing, if you can, or as you, if you are able to. So again, from this point, I want to say to the family, thank you, and we wish you God's blessings. And we don't know what tomorrow holds, but we know who holds tomorrow, and we wish you that God that holds tomorrow. So the benediction, and then the staff will take up from there. Thank you all.
Amen. Shall we rise up for the benediction? I know for many of us, this may be the last time we will get an opportunity to, you know, to view the body of Andrew. But this is what we can say, that this is not goodbye. Say amen. This is not goodbye. It is only see you later, because there is a day and time when we shall see each other face to face. Say amen. We shall see each other face to face. We shall see Jesus face to face. We shall have a celebration again, because God's promise is here with us. Amen. And now may the grace and the love of God be with us now and forevermore. Amen. We will see you again on the resurrection morning before the Lamb of God, if I don't get a chance to see you again. Amen.
I guess we'll sit and we'll be guided by the team. So you can take your seats, please.
Face tomorrow. To